Indeed. Thank you. Thank you. But before I start, let me say that recently a woman owed me money. She owed me money and I said, you need to pay me the money back. But she wouldn't give me the money. It was money that she owed me. It was for an exorcism I did on her. So she was repossessed. A weak joke, but better than no joke at all, yes. And I'll say as well that you know, recently I was out in my back garden a couple of nights ago, and my shed blew away. So if somebody could just lend me a comb, I'll put it back in again. Yes. I'll use this to take this off. It's a bit warm. I might put it back on later. Now, let me say that I think that there's a great story that we can tell about Paisley, Christian Shaw, witches, and the textile industry. Hence the title, Stephen Clancy, Paisley Forgotten Heritage. No, the title of... oh, thank you. Cotton on to Renfrewshire, from witches to stitches and riches. I think we can tell a story involving the witches, involving Christian Shaw, which is a positive story. It's a truthful story, a true story. I think we can give a different spin here. Now, I think this witchcraft in general is interesting. It's an interesting story, witchcraft in general, Scottish witchcraft in general, and the Renfrewshire story of witchcraft in particular. So I'll say a bit about all these things. Let me say, first of all, most of you know, Christian Shaw is known to history as the Bergarran imposter. Not a nice thing to say about anyone. She's regarded as some sort of nasty child who is responsible for the death of innocent people who were executed as witches. I think we can look at this in a different light, and I think we can give a more positive account, but still a true account, a true and truthful account. Now, I think it's interesting to know that witches... No, not at all. I might have said talk of the devil, but that's...
I'm going to move you up a wee bit because your hand keeps hitting the microphone.
Oh. Yes, I think it's interesting to think of witchcraft in terms of some matters of current social and political interest. Now, for instance, say take rape cases. It's often said that there's a problem with rape cases because there's a very low rate of convictions, and there's a thought that what we should do is alter the rules somehow so we can get a higher rate of convictions. I suggest that we should be really careful here, because there's a clear parallel with the witchcraft cases. Now, in witchcraft, there was a high rate of convictions and a low rate of acquittals. So was that good? Do we say this is really good? We've got a high rate of convictions, a low rate of acquittals. No, we didn't say that's necessarily good. So we shouldn't conversely say that something's gone wrong if there's a low rate of convictions. Now, the high rate of convictions was... came about partly because they said this is a witchcraft is an unusual sort of case. It's an unusual sort of case, like we now say about terrorism, for instance, as well as rape. That this is an unusual sort of case. If we don't adopt different practices, we're not going to get convictions. So let's adopt different practices. Now, among the different practices they adopted in the witchcraft trials was they used torture. Not in all cases, and maybe not quite as routinely as it's sometimes suggested, but the use of torture could be authorised in witchcraft cases. Number one, behold, you get a higher rate of convictions. No, not necessarily good. You know, I would suggest that what we want to do with laws and courts is establish just laws, establish just and fair procedures, and then we stand back, and whatever the outcome is, we accept the outcome. If the laws are fair, the procedures are fair, accept the outcomes. It's very dangerous to change the rules to get the outcome that we think would be better. I'm not saying you should never do it, but be very, very careful. Now, one of the things they did in the witchcraft trials, which was unusual, this was done in very few cases. It was only, I think, in the case of witchcraft and treason. And do you know what they allowed in these trials? Female witnesses. Female witnesses. Evidence from women wasn't used in civil cases as well, certainly not in criminal cases. But they made special allowances in some particular cases. They thought, otherwise, we're not going to get any convictions, so we'll change the rules. Now, you might have thought, well, actually, there should be women's evidence. So I'm not saying that. I'm not saying we should never change things. We only do it with great care. Talked recently of abolishing corroboration. Now, this is partly in legal cases, and this is partly because they don't like the outcomes, so we're going to change the rules. Just be careful. Just be very, very careful. We've tried this before. And I would say even more so just as much with terrorism. The notion in terrorist cases is when we arrest terrorists and try terrorists. Well, we're not going to get the convictions unless we change the rules. Be very, very careful. So there's at least, I think, one contempt of relevance. I won't go through all the possible ones. I'll just indicate some. And another one relates to the forthcoming referendum. I mean, it's sometimes said that somehow, if you make laws in Scotland for Scottish people, somehow that would be better laws than you would get if the laws were made, say, in the UK for UK people, or laws made elsewhere for Scottish people. It's an interesting idea, and I don't mean just to take it as a bit of political propaganda and attack it from whatever side my politics might be. But if it's an idea that we want to take seriously, and say, is this the case? Well, here's a good test case. In 1563, there was the Scottish Witch Act that made witchcraft a criminal offence in Scotland. 1563, there was a witchcraft act that modified the previous witchcraft act, but then decided what the law concerning witchcraft was in England. Now, are we going to say that the crime made in Scotland pertaining to Scottish witchcraft was a better law than the English law, or a better law for Scotland? And we're saying that their law, that the English law for England, that was a good law for England, but our law for Scotland was a better law for Scotland. It's an interesting idea, but you would need to give a good argument for that. I mean, partly because, at least on the face of it, I think if I was living in Scotland at the time of the witch hunts, I think I might have preferred it if it was the English law that applied to Scotland rather than the Scottish law. For instance, torture was used in the Scottish cases, not in the English ones. And it was torture better for us. Somehow that was a good thing for Scottish alleged witches. Maybe not so good for other ones, but for our alleged witches, this was a good thing. Similarly, for the actual the actual nature of the offence in Scotland. You've got to be careful here, because you can look at what it says in the Acts, what's written down as the law, but actually what the law is isn't just what is written down. Often what the law is what the courts see what is written down means. Often that is what the law is, what the courts see this means. And sometimes the interpretations can be something quite staggering. But with that qualification in mind, there is this difference that, and I'm not saying all was what is quite like this, but there's this broad difference that in Scotland, the offence of witchcraft, it was more like being a witch, that being in league with the devil, having renounced your soul to the devil, and also consulting with a witch. If you consulted with another witch, or somebody who was deemed a witch, now you might not have thought the person as a witch, you might have thought the person as a healer of some sort, but if that was deemed to be witchcraft, that was a capital offence. So it was a capital offence both to be a witch and a capital offence to consult a witch. With the English legislation, there were degrees of punishment. To be guilty of witchcraft didn't mean they were going to execute you. Not the first time. There could be maybe a year in prison, don't do it again. But it wasn't the case of we're going to execute you. Similarly, to establish a basis, well, at least for executing someone in England, and possibly usually even for a punishment, there had to be the note of harm. It had to be shown, or agreed to be shown, that you had harmed somebody with witchcraft. But that wasn't the case in Scotland. There was, for instance, there was a lady called Bessie Payne, 1661, she was executed for witchcraft. And I always think she's a particularly unlucky experience. If you look at the various accusations that were levelled at her, it was never suggested that she harmed anyone. The basis of the case against her, it was something like this. She was minding her own business, let's say, approached with people, asked if they would help her, if they would help to cure their cows. Their cows had ailments of some sort. Would she help to cure them? Yes, you would do that. Mistake, Bessie. Big mistake. Executed as a witch. I mean, no suggestion that she did anything but good, but how she did it. For being a witch, she got executed. So there were these differences. As I say, history is often the interpretation that you make of it. Witchcraft, I think, is a really good example where it alerts us to a question that we don't ask sufficiently concerning crimes. That is the question, well, what is the justification for making something a crime? Why should it be a crime to be a witch if this means to cast spells that cure people's cows? You know, why should that be a crime? What is the nature of the act that makes it a crime? Now, I suggest we don't ask this question sufficiently. When Parliament, Westminster, Holyrood, anywhere, pass an act that makes something a crime, and it says, not only don't do that, but if you do that, you'll be punished, maybe sent to jail, your life ruined. We should ask the question, what is the justification for doing that? I suggest that witchcraft shows what was there all along, that we don't take this question seriously enough. And really question a politician, why are you passing this law? But here's the suggestion. We would all agree that you shouldn't be punished for an offence unless it can be shown beyond all reasonable doubt that you did it. Unless it can be shown beyond all reasonable doubt that you did it, then we shouldn't punish somebody for that offence. I give this suggestion to you. Should we not also ask this question? If we are going to punish people for particular actions, can we say beyond all reasonable doubt that people should be punished for that sort of action? There's some things we can say, actions like rape's a good case in point. Beyond all reasonable doubt, beyond all reasonable doubt, people should be punished for having sex with someone without that person's consent. Beyond all reasonable doubt, that should be a crime. Beyond all reasonable doubt, should it be a crime to renounce Christ in your baptism and worship the devil? Should that be a crime? Beyond all reasonable doubt, should it be a crime, punishable action, to cast a spell and cure a cow? Beyond all reasonable doubt, should it be a crime to go to Ibrox and sing a particular song and to produce a particular chant? Beyond all reasonable doubt, should that be a crime? And so forth. I think we should apply the same test to all these anytime there's a crime. And I think, I mean, there's so many respects in which I think witchcraft is relevant to the way we think about current issues. That, I mean, I could spend a fortnight on that, never mind just a lecture or a talk. I'll just mention one thing today. I won't follow it through, but throw it up. And that is just the nature of women and the law. I mean, here seems a good case where women are getting a rough deal, in that most people who were accused of witchcraft were female. And also, there's the various general connotations that go with the stereotype of the witch, or the ugly lady, and all the rest of it. In fact, there's exhibitions of paintings in Edinburgh recently with the idea of some of witchcraft is misogyny, and somehow this is some characteristic of the way women are treated by the law in general, or society in general. No, there's certainly something in the idea, and it's a good test case, but I think we should be careful. I mean, apart from anything else, if you look at crime in general, both at the time of the witchcraft cases and now, you find that for most crimes, most of the accused are male. For most crimes, most of the accused are male. I mean, murder is a good example. Most people accused of murder are male. So did we say, well, look at what a rough deal males get from the law? Does this show the anti-masculine? No, we don't say that. Well, we've got to be careful if in one of the few crimes where most of them are, those accused are female, that we say, ah, well, this shows an anti-feminism. It's more complicated than that. I mean, there are various interesting elements relating to males and females going on, but it's complicated and interesting, more interesting story. I mean, for instance, here's an interesting difference, that with witches, the traditional accusation was that they met the devil appeared in the form of a man, the devil had sex with them. No, you might think, oh, wait a minute, that's interesting. If that was what happened with female witches, devil was a man, they had sex with them the normal way, we presume.
What happened, you would might ask, with male witches? It was something like, looking at the numbers overall, it was something like, about, say, 85% were female. Still these 15-16% male. What about male witches? When the devil appeared to males, did the devil appear as a woman? Or when the devil appeared to males, did they have homosexual sex? Interesting questions. The answer is that although women witches were said to have sex with the devil, male witches weren't. The sexual element was different. So there are interesting things going on regarding feminism and women and so forth. But it's got to be careful with. It's not just a straightforward thing. And if you look at what happened within the actual court procedures, let's say it was something like 84-85% of those accused were female. Let's say a figure like that. Well, if you look at the various elements in the process, let's say of those accused, 84% female. Of those who were put to trial, 84% of those were female. Of those who were found guilty, similar numbers of those were female. And of those executed, similar numbers of female. I mean, it wasn't as if this bias, there's a bias if they stayed there. And interestingly, you might find this strange, for me to say this, but one of the reasons most people, those who are accused of murder, most of them are male. Now, I think it would be best because most people who commit murders are male. Well, the same with witchcraft. I mean, it might have been most of those who were accused of witchcraft were female. It might have been because most witches were female. Now you might say, wait a minute, nobody was a witch. Well, actually, yes, they were. At least in terms of the Scottish crime of witchcraft. Because the way the crime was described, to be a witch was to... You didn't need to be a successful witch. You see, it didn't need to work. In order for witchcraft to be an offence and to be guilty, you could be an unsuccessful witch. To be a witch, it was sufficient to purport to be one. It was sufficient to try, to dabble. That was enough. That could make you guilty. And it's happened in some cases. It was done for money. Say the Bessie Payne case, I don't think she did it for money, but some people did it for money. So there's no question some people were witches, clearly guilty. It's not clear who was and who wasn't, but some were. But the question is, the most significant thing is, although they were guilty of witchcraft, they were guilty of doing something which shouldn't have been a crime. It's not that they were treated unfairly by the courts, because the courts did their best. Then as now, the courts have got to uphold the laws, the good ones and the bad ones. And there are plenty of bad ones, then and now. The courts have got to do their best to deal with that. Where they get the rough deal from with the politicians passing the law in the first place. That was what was wrong. Now, I suggest that witchcraft in general is interesting. And it's current things that relates to in terms of current issues. Now let's look at again at the Paisley case. Now, the traditional interpretation is that Christian Shaw, when she was say 11 or 12 years old, falsely accused various people of bewitching her. But these people ended up, as they say, very, very badly killed, which is a facetious way of saying that they were executed. And the general view is that it was her fault, that she was responsible, that she did it. Why did she do it? Like a kind of nastiness or spite. And how did she do it? Well, she had fits of various sorts. She had fits of various sorts. And surely some of these fits should be deaf. She could be in a She'd go for periods without seeing anything. But they would see. And then she would get into periods of hysterical laughter. And she would point to various bite marks, scratch marks on her hands and arms. And she would say that people that she named as invisible tormentors, they did it to her. And she would even indicate they were in the room. Nobody else could see these people. She could. No, they were not all of these people that she accused. Or set, she'd say, this is what was said to have happened. Not all of these people were executed, but some of them were. She would swallow her tongue. That was another thing she did. And sometimes her eyes rolled about in her head in strange ways. And there's references to her upper head coming round. I think in some of these films is it the exorcism when the head actually spins. This is it doesn't stay quite that, the allusions to that, but that suggestion of that she said her bent over backwards like a bowl, to be stiff as a board. I think what they mean is bent over that way with her sort of head back towards her ankle. I tried that a couple of days ago to see how far you could go. I mean, I wonder how far you'd be thought to be able to go before Sandy would say, well, that's remarkable. I mean, after all, that's probably quite far back, because not only do I do yoga, but I'm a married man, a very happily married man. So you know what that means. Well, I'm used to bending over backwards to please my wife, so I can probably do it better than most people. Her stomach swelled. She looked as if she was pregnant. She took objects from her mouth, a straw, eggshells, and such like. She said that people forced her, these invisible tormentors pushed them down her throat. And she had various conversations with these people too, that nobody else could hear the other side of the dialogue. And between these various fits that she had, she was perfectly happy and normal. Now, the traditional view, the traditional view that I suggest started around about 1785 or after that. Now, this, we say 1697 was the trial, so the events described were a couple of years before then. The traditional view is that she was a fraudster, and that gullible adults saw this. And on the basis of this, went and got hold of these people and executed them. The traditional notion. And I think the traditional notion, it comes from somebody called Hugo Arnott, who published in 1785 a book called A Collection of Celebrated Criminal Trials. Now he describes the events, it's hard done. And he calls her the Bergarin imposter. This 11, 12 year old child, Christian Shaw, the daughter of the the Laird of Erskine, John Shaw.
That gentleman there, in fact. Now, I don't know that much about Hugo Arnott, but it's clear he's quite an eccentric character.
He is quite an eccentric sort of a character.
And I think a collection of celebrated criminal trials, I mean, I'm not saying it was lies, but I think there's a shock element involved there. You know, he's looking for the juicy bits. And he bases this account of what he says happened not on the actual court records or any official legal testimony. He bases this account on a book that was written about Christian Shaw, published in 1693. There was more than one version of this book with slightly different titles, which is another interesting element of the story. But let's say that at least one of them was called, and they're very similar. They're very, very similar. A book published in 1698 called "A True Narrative of the Sufferings and Relief of a Young Girl, Strangely Molested by Evil Spirits and Their Instruments in the West." Yeah, that's not the Wild West, that's Paisley, Renfrewshire. Or maybe it was the Wild West, maybe right the first thing. He looks at that. Now, that a particular account of what happened, this has become the way people interpret, look back and think of the Renfrewshire witchcraft cases. But that's not what happens. Or at least, it was just a tiny aspect of it. And an aspect that is subject to all sorts of interpretations. I mean, the basic one is, what the hell's going on here? You know, what? This true narrative, is the, I mean, if you write in the title a true narrative, it doesn't necessarily lead people to think it will be one. But this true narrative is very, very like another true narrative of the Salem cases. In fact, if I received this true narrative from a student as a dissertation, I'd say it's plagiarism. It's just the same. It's just the same as the one, the Salem one. At the very least, it's obvious that the author of this narrative knows about the Salem case. And it's written with a clear point of view and a clear purpose. And actually, it follows in a tradition of such narratives. I mean, there's not dozens of them, maybe a dozen of them throughout the years. This is the picture. This is the picture. Someone becomes ill, often a child, not always, but often a child. And people can't explain what's gone wrong with the child. They can't, or the ill person. Now, they try all conventional treatments. They go to doctors, they go to the experts, and these experts, they say, we cannot explain this in terms of our medical knowledge. And then, it's described after a time, somebody says, wait a minute, maybe it's witchcraft. Say, witchcraft, I never thought of that, witchcraft. Then, God comes in, puts a stop to it, and people say, this is just like Job. Just as God allowed the devil to torment Job, God allowed the devil to torment Christian Shaw. But Christian Shaw resisted all this temptation of the devil. Then God stepped in and says, no more, I'm going to restore you. Christian Shaw was restored. Moral of the story, atheists are wrong. The devil exists, therefore God exists. It's a propaganda piece for God. And that's fine. I'm not against propaganda pieces of God, but
we don't need to resort to such unfair tactics. Now, if you look at what actually happened, this is what happened. That 7 people were executed as witches. There were a chunk of various things. The 7 of them that were, let's give them their names: Catherine Campbell, Agnes Naismith, Margaret Fulton, Margaret Lang, John and James Lindsay, and another John Lindsay. 7 of them. And there was another John Reed, a blacksmith, who seems to have committed suicide. Notice, incidentally, the with the sex breakdown, it's almost 50-50 males and females. I think partly because they didn't. Our stereotypes are not necessarily their stereotypes, and I don't think then they particularly thought of it as a female thing. These are what the 7 were charged with. They were charged with murder by witchcraft of a minister called John Hardy, minister at Dumbarton. Murder by witchcraft of a minister called John Hardy. Murder to several children. Now, at least one of them was a minister's child. And I think this is partly it was partly important in propelling the thing along. You see, I think the people that looked into these matters, got evidence, appealed to the Privy Council for permission to try people. Often they were ministers, and I think that, in fact, I know that what happened to some of them. I think this was significant was that from their own experience, either their wife, as happened with the minister in Salem, either their wife had been killed with the devil through witchcraft, or their children, babies in particular, had been killed by witchcraft, and they were fighting against the devil. Well, okay, we might not think that the devil killed their wife and their babies, but they did. They did. It was sincere. They were sincere, that I think, or suggest. So, the murder of John Hardy, several children. They were accused of capsizing the Erskine ferry boat by witchcraft, and thereby drowning the Laird of Brighouse and the ferryman, who was called John Glenn. They were accused of drowning him for witchcraft. And several horses. Several horses were killed as a result of their witchcraft there. Oh yes, and they were also accused of bewitching Christian Shaw. But this was part of a huge package. Well, a huge package. That a big package. The bewitching Christian Shaw, this wasn't central to it. The way it's central to the narrative, but that's really all it talks about in the narrative written about Christian Shaw. But this wasn't what the court case was about. Now, I'm guessing here, but I suggest that if the bewitchment of Christian Shaw had been taken out of this charge sheet, they would still have been executed. It wasn't for the Christian Shaw case alone, far from it. There's plenty there to get them. Now, Christian Shaw wasn't responsible for the charges related to the John Hardy and so forth. Now, even concerning the charge against the accused witches that they had bewitched Christian Shaw, I mean, she wasn't responsible for mounting the case. I mean, for instance, they were tortured. She didn't torture them. They were arrested. She didn't arrest them. She wasn't on the jury. she didn't apply to the Privy Council for the authorisation to charge these particular people. It wasn't her. An 11-year-old child didn't do that, even pertaining to that aspect of the charge, which was against her. Now, among the evidence was that at least a couple of the accused had the witch's mark. Now, what this was some part of her body that didn't bleed, and was insensible to pain. Now, there's a still existent accounts where a couple of ministers, Andrew Turner, minister at Renfrew, and James Brisbane, minister at Kilmacombe, they give testament that they witnessed what happened when a couple of these witches were tested for the witch's mark. And the idea was, I mean, in part of the mythology seems to be that the devil might have touched her at some point. Something particular. Hot or cold point. I think we know now from acupuncture that if you do stick pins into various parts of your body, sometimes it doesn't bleed, and sometimes you don't feel it. But usually you do. So for these ministers to get to the point, they could say, yes, there was part of this body, when the hammer, and they talk about some of the nails, they used a hammer to hammer into the body. Some of the nails bent. But they got bits where there was no blood. And they got bits when the witches didn't scream out in pain. So, and that was part of the evidence. Now, that wasn't Christian Shaw that did that. That wasn't Christian Shaw. That was these named ministers. Now, over 80 people gave evidence. The thing is, I've seen giving evidence. Nowadays, it's more clear-cut, various elements of the trial. What is a trial? What is trial evidence? And what is the evidence for to do with charges and statements and so forth? The distinctions are probably bigger in the past there. But let's say that 80 people gave evidence for the cases in general. Now, Christine Shaw, it's not clear that she even gave any evidence of any sort. But I think it looks as if there might have been some questioning of it. But it was specified that she wasn't asked to say anything under oath. There was nothing under oath. Or those that double evidence clear that was to be officially submitted. And if it even is a record of what she's supposed to say, I don't remember, have you come across any actual? No. I know, but I mean, for people that are academically interested in history, this would be great to find this, but no, I've never actually found it. There's no evidence that she even gave any evidence. Never mind, just part of it. And if you look too, at the actual book, what's in the set of terms, a lot of it just doesn't quite fit. The thing is, if you look at what she was said to have done, both by other people in the testifying the court, and what she was said to have done in the narrative of the suffering of the little girl, some of the elements might fit. Some of the elements might fit theory that she was it was a hoax, that she was a fraudster. Some of them might, but they don't all. They don't all. Some of them might fit theory that she was some kind of mental illness of some sort. But they don't all. It won't do as an explanation of all. There's something else going on. I think either lies or honest errors. No, for instance, one of the things it said, it said that she moved about without her feet touching the ground. It's described that, at least in some occasions, she moved about the room but her feet didn't touch the ground. Now, what the reader of the narrative of the suffering of the little girl is invited to think is that it was the invisible tormentors. You see, it's these people that were invisible to everyone else. They were throwing her about. You see, that's why her feet didn't touch the ground, because they were lifting her about, throwing her about. That's why her feet didn't touch the ground, you see. Now, if you say, we're not going to put that we don't believe that interpretation, well, what do you think? You think it was a trick. It's a bloody good trick. It's a trick. That's not easy to do as a trick. Was it mental illness? No, I don't see it. I mean, no matter how mentally ill you are, it's difficult to see how you could give this I think something else. Not necessarily deliberate lies, but more a case of describing an event, talking about the event to various people, writing an account of it, rewriting an account of it, and before you know where you are, you've got without setting out to give a deliberate lie, you've got something that's less than the more than the whole truth, if you like. And I said she produced things from her mouth, the eggshells. What else did I say? Yes, straw. But among other things was hot embers. With even some suggestion that it would be even too hot to hold. How did she do that? And it was specified that they were perfectly dry. It wasn't regurgitated. Not an easy word to say. Regurgitated from her stomach. They said they were dry. They were really warm. How did she do that? Maybe she didn't do that, is the answer. Despite what it said.
You've got 5 minutes.
Is that right? My goodness.
We want to go into Stiches and Ritches.
Yes. My goodness. I'll speed up. I suggest that Christian Shaw was innocent. Christian Shaw was not guilty of accusing people. I suggest that she was used as somebody to tell a story about. That's what it was. People told the story about her. And she wasn't the Vulgarian imposter at all. And nobody thought that during her life. But during her life, she married a minister, John Miller. Now that would have been difficult if she'd been known during her life as the Vulgarian imposter. I don't know if the congregation would have put up with that. She founded the Vulgarian Thread Company, which formed the basis of the prosperity of Paisley. And I suggest that we've got a good story to tell here, both about witches, thread, Christian Shaw goes through the story. And I think we can use Christian Shaw as a feminist icon. It's a woman who played a great part in history. Here is a woman who was involved in business. Here is a woman of clear initiative. And I think she should be regarded more academically as such and for the general public. To sum up things quickly, let me say, I speak as an academic, and I think trying to say, look, here's a story that can be truly and truthfully told. But the marketers, the advertisers, there's various elements that they can pick out of it. Let me suggest that we should, some things I would like to see done. Some sound fanciful, but say give ideas.
Now, this is a fanciful idea, but it shouldn't be. We've got an airport in Paisley. It's called Glasgow Airport, Glasgow International Airport. Now, I think it's not a horrible title, but it does no good for Glasgow. Just nothing for Glasgow. Just nothing for the airport. If only it were called Glasgow Christian Shaw Airport at Paisley. Now, why not? I mean, there's George Best, Belfast. Christian Shaw is more important to Paisley, done more for Paisley and Renfrewshire than George Best for Belfast. Or John Lennon, Liverpool. The Glasgow Christian Shaw Airport. Bergarin, the Bergarin imposter, we don't need to, we can use the word imposter ironically, we can say the alleged imposter, so-called imposter. This is a world famous term. I think we should use it. Bergarin, I said that the Breehead was the Breehead Centre. Breehead, I mean, it's not a bad title, it isn't doing anything. Not the Bergarin. Why did they choose the Bergarin? They're near enough. You know, you get in Paisley, you get places called the Abbey, all sorts of things. Not all that close to the Abbey. You can easily stretch these things. I think the term should be used. I think this should be a statue. I think this should be a statue, or as I've written down here, a plaque. But I think I meant a plaque. This should be not a plaque to Christian Shaw, this should be at least a plaque. And wouldn't it be great if Sandy Stortup could do a statue of me? No, a statue. No, I didn't mean it. I just thought of that as a last minute. If they could do a stack, it would be absolutely tremendous. And in terms of a witchcraft trail, both virtual and actual, I think we should make it larger than it might actually seem at the moment. Like, for instance, the Erskine Ferry would need to be, the site of the Erskine Ferry would be part of it. Dumbarton would need to be part of it. Johnston. Like, for instance, where did she stay? Where was the thread company set up? I'd love to know. Various churches and kirkyards, they came into the story with the local ministers were involved with this. They were the ones that drove it. Now, I believe, I just saw this recently, that it's called Kennan Kirkyard. Killellan. It's been renovated.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, they were part of the witch's story. You see, there's not only in terms of a virtual and physical trail, but in Gobarkin, Kilmacombe, they're all part of the story. And a minibus could go around and ferry tourists around and show them these various bits. Now, it's great the fabled vision of, it's great the photograph various aspects of the enactment, but even be good as well if there could be a film of this. I mean, from a Hollywood feature film, you know, not a kind of documentary, even historical, just using it somehow. But preferably using the Christian Shaw not as some sort of victim or some sort of ill person or some sort of pawn, but as a powerful woman that we should celebrate. That we should celebrate. I'd love to speak more, but I better stop. Let me pause. Goodness, it'd be a pity if I didn't just take a second. If I could just plug my book. Such a marvellous audience, I'm not going to miss the chance. The Kirk Satan of Salem, A History of the Witches of Renfrewshire, there's various elements relating to the story. Pieces about it written by current academics, plus documents of the past, and make drawing connections between Salem and Renfrewshire. I think there are very interesting parallels there. And there's a book by Brown and Ferguson editors. It's called Twisted Sisters: Women Climbing Deviants in Scotland Since 2 o'clock. No, I said that for humanist effect, but you remember now, since 1400. Women climbing deviants in Scotland since 1400. And got a long piece there on the called the bewitchment of Christian Shaw, a reassessment. Let me finish by thanking you very much and saying, cotton on to Paisley, it's magic, you know. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, Hugh.
Thank you.
You'll be delighted to...